Okay, that's the, I don't think I left anything important out. This is Tyler, I'm gonna let him tell you about himself because he knows more about him than I do, and...
That's debatable.
Well... Okay.
All right. So I wrote this slide so I wouldn't have to tell you who I am. But I'm going to anyway. So I'm the database support manager for Engineer, and I've been a DBA now for about 12 years, the last 9 of which have been with Engineer. We've offered MongoDB as a custom add-on for about the last 6 years, and while it's not a official fully supported database, we do support it on the best effort basis. And for the past 8 months or so, we've been preparing and ramping up to add MongoDB as a fully supported stack offering. So as a result, my team's been actively training and stuff like that, studying MongoDB deployment practices to make sure that when we're building our solution, it follows along with the best practices for MongoDB deployments and provides access to the features that the best features Mongo has to offer. Which is not a small undertaking at all. Yeah, okay, that's fine. Sorry. Are we recording?
Yeah, it should be.
Okay.
I'll double check the framing.
I'll just keep talking then.
Yeah, keep going.
So this is meant to be a starting point. Mongo is a very large and complex database system, so it's not really possible to cover everything in the limited time that we have here. The Mongo documentation is quite excellent, and MongoDB also offers free MongoDB training courses online at university.mongodb.com. And this really isn't meant to cover all the things. So just talking about technology specifics, most of the stuff that I'm going to refer to here is based on Gentoo or Ubuntu operating systems, MongoDB, the newer versions, 3.2 or 3.4, and MMAT v1. Of course, Mongo now offers the Wired Tiger storage engine, which offers encrypted storage, but that's pretty new, so I haven't really explored it very much. So MongoDB. It was originally developed by TenGen as a planned platform as a service offering. Mongo was released to the open source community back in 2009. It's a NoSQL database store, and it supports scale out on commodity hardware via sharding, essentially horizontal partitioning. It uses a JSON-like document structure that provides a semi-structured data set. And it provides data replication infrastructure called replica sets with automated takeover facilitated through elections. And it also provides durability and tuning capabilities both at the replica set or the individual write level that trades away some of the performance for consistency, which is actually one of the things that for a long time Mongo took heat for. But it's about using the right tool for the job. So a lot of the terminology is kind of similar, overlapping. Database is a database, a table or relation is a collection, a row or a tuple is a document, a column is a field, and an index is an index. So it's closely related to a key value store. Basically, a key value store is providing a very simple data model which stores values identified by a unique key. The data types can be comparably complex, but the basic idea behind a key value store is that what is stored as the value is completely opaque to the database system. So the database itself doesn't really do much beyond setting or getting whatever is in that object. A document data store is an extension of that model, and it requires values that are stored in a somewhat structured format. Typically XML or JSON. The structure can be used to work within the database engine and can actually be indexed and searched. Documents are often stored... Sorry, I just said that. each document actually defines its own schema structure independently. Related documents are then grouped into collections, such as books, orders, logs, but they may not have the same set of keys within the actual underlying document. Mongo uses something called BSON, or Bison. I've heard it said both ways. It's a binary encoded format of JSON, and it provides some additional data types such as date, timestamp, and binary data. Encoding and decoding Bison data is very fast in most of the languages you're going to use because the underlying data types are C-based. And allows you to search and index within embedded objects within documents. So here's an example. As a result, documents within MongoDB look quite a bit like straight JSON. In fact, the only thing in this example that's not would be the date field there. So this is an example of our March meetup that never actually happened. Of course, this is the same meetup basically, just a different date. Sorry, I should mention some things there. So you've basically got this speakers object, which is an array of embedded objects. And the sponsors object, the same thing. Our sponsors are Engineered and Stark and Wayne. Make sure you tweet at them if you get a chance. Thank them for supporting us. And if we jump into April, we've got our lightning talks here, but we don't actually know who the speakers are yet, so it's not even in this document. So there's still time slots available. Make sure you reach out to Charlie or let one of us know that you're interested in talking. Just a 5-minute talk. You don't have to have slides. Something you're interested in, maybe technology related would be nice, but it's not required. So a lightning talk about lightning ones. It was pretty interesting. All right, so the Mongo CLI looks a bit like this. It's basically a JavaScript based client. You can show the DBs, and it's got the DB databases listed. We don't have anything interesting. These are just the default ones that were there, except for the M202, which was used for one of the Mongo training courses that I did. So you can just do an insert against one of those DBs. You can say use DB. That doesn't create the database, but as soon as you insert the first object, it'll create the database for you automatically. So I inserted the object we were talking about before for March, and it created my TP test database that I was using. I'm just trying to think if there was anything else. No, we're good. All right, so to pull that back out, I'm just doing a db.meetups.find, and then I'm doing a pretty formatting on it so that it makes it more human readable. Otherwise, it's just all smushed onto one line. Basically, this is the find there is just to find everything. I haven't specified a search clause at all there. We'll talk about search clauses in a minute. So we'll go ahead and do the insert for April. And again, Mongo responds and says, yeah, I inserted that. Okay, we're good to go. All right, so... so we've got this object now, and... So this is kind of interesting. If we go back to the previous insert, the ID is 1. And the reason the ID is 1 is because when I inserted it, I said insert with ID of 1. When I did this insert, I didn't give it an ID, so it assigned one. Every single object within a collection has an ID that's kind of like, think of it like a primary key, basically. It's meant to be a unique value. I don't think it's promised to be unique, but it's unique enough. It's basically a 4-byte value representing the second since the Unix epoch, a 3-byte machine identifier, a 2-byte process ID, and then a 3-byte counter that starts with a random value.
Genies, it looks unique to me.
So, if you deploy enough MongoDB instances, you could have an ID over here matching an ID over here, but if you run enough inserts, I guess, that whole infinite monkeys at infinite typewriters problem. right? All right, so let's say we want to do an update. Well, first we need some way to search to find the object we want to update. So here's an example where we're just going to search by the date, and we're going to say date is greater than April 1st, and date is less than May 1st. So we're looking at the April event. So we want to add the speakers list to this object. So we're going to do a db.meetups.update, and we're going to add our search clause, and then we're going to put a comment, and we're going to put the change that we want to the document in there. So one matched, one modified. But now we do a search, and it doesn't come back with anything. So the problem is what happened there is what we told Mongo to do is we told it to replace what is in that document with this. And Mongo's like, sure, I'm good with that. So what you actually have to do is you have to tell it set speakers and actually set the speakers and then it will update as appropriate. So the moral of the story, if you update without set and unset, you might get upset. Thanks, Charlie. All right, so we're going to go ahead and remove March 9th because that meetup actually never happened, and we're here on the 29th instead. So figure out the search clause that gets us that. Obviously, if it was a larger table, that wouldn't be a good way to do the search, but it works for these purposes, and we can remove where speakers.name is tied up all. Obviously, you know, that would remove all the documents with that person in there, so that wouldn't necessarily be a great thing. Six common client commands, show DBs, use DB name, db.help, that one's especially valuable. DB.get collections name, collection names, rs.status, this gives you information about the replica set, and this gives you replica set commands. We'll talk about replica sets in a few minutes. So, do a little bit of a live demo. As I mentioned, it is JavaScript, so you can actually write your own functions in it. And so I wrote this little one to just to kind of amuse myself, and basically what it's doing is it's going to grab a random quote from the quotes collection and return it to the console. The kind of the cool thing about this is if you want to know how a function works, you just don't supply the parentheses. If you want to run the function, so supply the parentheses.
You're looping there. I'm not sure how that works. The for each?
For each.
It's a collection of size one.
I see. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, obviously it's kind of a little bit of an abusive thing, but I was just doing it to amuse myself. So I ran 3 miles today. Finally, I said, lady, take your purse. My ex-girlfriend had weekly lessons on with the devil on how to become more evil. I don't know how much she charged me. Picked up a hitchhiker. Well, you got him when you hit him.
Could we go back to the cat pictures?
Tell me who the comedian is.
Abel Phillips. Was I right?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
All right, so just a quick demonstration there, anyway. All right, so now we're going to get into best practices. We're going to talk about backup recovery, security, availability, sizing, scaling, consistency, and monitoring. I don't know if any of you guys were watching, but this headline doesn't quite fit the outage. This was February, yeah, right at the end of January, beginning of February. So basically what happened is GitLab was trying to resync a Postgres replica database, and they deleted a directory on the wrong server, effectively wiped out their production database because the replica was already wiped out and they were trying to copy data to it. So their LVM snapshots and logical backups were scheduled daily. The logical backups were failing silently due to a mismatch between the client version and the server version. So they had like a 9.2 client trying to talk to a 9.5 server or something like that. They weren't. I don't think those details were specifically listed, but these are basically the details from their postmortem, which was actually done very publicly. Their platform as a service level backups were actually not configured for their database systems. They were configured for NFS shares. But they were fortunate that earlier that day they had done an LVM snapshot and transferred it to staging. The problem with that was that they hadn't optimized staging storage performance because they weren't worried about that. So they had to copy data back from staging, which had much slower drives to work with. So the end result was just over 24 hours of downtime. Just over 24 hours of downtime. 6 hours of data lost. 5,000 comments lost. 707 user accounts lost. And 5,037 projects had their records removed. Resulting in the loss of any issues associated with those projects. The underlying Git repositories were actually part of disk storage, so they weren't lost. Just a lot of references to those had to be rebuilt after the fact. So, the first step of creating a backup solution is schedule when you're going to test it. Do this before you even start writing your tool. Figure out when you're going to test it and set a reoccurring event. You have a hosted provider. Do they test your backups? They probably don't. Chances are they have no idea what your recovery point objective is, and they don't know what your recovery time objective is either. Add to this that the data has to be restored somewhere. So should your provider be taking that data off of your controlled hosts and putting it on their controlled hosts? The answer to that is no, in my opinion, but I mean, you're welcome to disagree. So a good way to test, assuming you don't have any compliance requirements to follow or have loose compliance requirements, is to use the actual production data on your testing systems. That data often needs to be refreshed with regular copies of data anyway. So by using production data, you're kind of killing two birds with one stone. So first, you need to think, so once you've got your resource test scheduled, you need to think about your recovery point objective. And this is, if you lose all your data, how many transactions, how many hours of data can you afford to lose to whatever that restore point is? Can you lose 6 hours of data? Can you lose 24 hours of data? Can you lose a week of data? That's important so that you can design something that is either at least backs up at that interval or provides diffs for the for covering the difference in time. Next up is recovery time objective. You got to figure out how long is it going to take me to restore this data? What is the amount of time that's acceptable to be down? Then you need to define your retention plan, determine if your backups are going to be on-site or off-site, how long they're going to be kept in each of those places. Then you need to actually design and build your backup solution. And when you do this, make sure that in the event of a failure, you'll be alerted and that you can monitor somewhere that the backup state is actually healthy. This could be as simple as having it send an email when it successfully completes, or it could be something on your existing NOC dashboard that just tells you the status of the last backup and highlights it if it's a problem. Maybe it's something that also reports on the size so that you can see if the size is out of character for your backups. Because one of the ways that backups are notorious for failing is they get 90% of the backup done and they encounter some error and they actually put that backup up there like it's a good backup, but you wouldn't know unless you're actually tracking the size that it's missing the last few tables or something like that. Should your backup be encrypted? And are you going to trust that encryption to your own tools, or are you going to let whatever offsite provider you're using determine that for you? I'm a big fan of encrypting it with your own tools. Because provider-based encryption, they're holding the keys. So what's that really providing you? And it doesn't provide you transport security necessarily either. So, and then of course, test it. All tests should be an end-to-end test. Means pulling a backup from offsite storage, restoring it, testing it with your application, making sure that it actually works, making sure that the data is valid and complete. And then, of course, obey your calendar schedule and make sure you're testing at regular intervals. All right, so how do we backup MongoDB? Well, for logical backups, we use Mongo Dump and Mongo Restore. These work with a BSON representation, so it's maintaining the fidelity of your binary data, and can be used to migrate between storage engines within Mongo for a standalone instance. Reads data from the database, which provides validation of file consistency. So one of the issues with taking a snapshot and just trusting that that's your data is if the data has a file system corruption, it's going to copy that corruption for you, and you're not going to know anything about it until you try to use it. A logical backup actually touches the data. It's actually reading the data from disk, so you know that your data is, you not only validate that your disk is consistent, but you're actually validating you can read all of your data. Of course, a logical backup can be combined with compression, which can significantly decrease the actual backup size. The drawbacks are you're actually reading all the physical data from the database. So that can hurt your memory caches. That can hurt performance, especially if you're backing up against the primary, which is probably one of the more common approaches. Re-importing the data that you've backed up can take an exceptionally long amount of time because it's got to reinsert all those bytes and objects, and it's got to regenerate indexing as needed for that. The logical backup solutions only back up the metadata, the description of how things are indexed. When working with replica sets, backup can be set to run against the closest node based on network latency or on the primary. For performance purposes, you usually want to try and run that against the secondary if your consistency rules allow that. But keep in mind that even if you are specifically backing up against a secondary, if there's a failure somewhere in the cluster during the backup, that secondary could be promoted to the primary role. And it's not common. You have so many nodes to choose from, and this one is kind of lagging when it's responding to the election process, so maybe he's not the best candidate. And for sharded clusters, Mongo S will by default read from the primary. That can be changed, basically what it's trying to do is it's trying to make sure that it's getting data from a consistent node, because you want to make sure that you're getting a consistent view of the entire cluster when you're doing that. And we'll talk a little bit more about MongoS later. All right, so then you've got your physical backups and logical volume manager snapshots, or infrastructure-based snapshots, like EBS snapshots would be a good example, can be used to get a consistent view of your data. The journal is a write-ahead log that Mongo uses to provide durability in the event of a failure. How Mongo writes this is, of course, dependent on the storage engine, but The important factor is that you're storing this with your actual data, so that when you're taking a snapshot, you're getting copies of both. And on a sharded cluster, it's important to stop the balancer, which is what moves data between shards and balances the data, and initiate a snapshot on each of the shards as well as a config server at the same time, while that balancer is stopped, just so that you're getting all the data across the entire cluster at a given point in time. Another option is you can use a copy or an rsync, but the unfortunate drawback to this is it's downtime. You've actually got to stop the server in order to get a consistent data copy using those methods. These backups are huge. Well, if your data is, anyway. They contain the indexes, they copy the internal storage padding and fragmentation, and because they're binary, they're not going to compress very well. The nice thing about most snapshots is they're differentials. So each snapshot builds on what the last one had. So an approach to using this type of backup is you could set a replica set member that you're going to shut down when you're doing your backups and do the copy using it. Of course, there's a risk of that node not being able to rejoin the cluster if the rest of the cluster gets too far ahead of it, if the backup takes too long. So there is this thing called Mongo Export and Mongo Import. And the reason you want to avoid those is they're JSON tools. So they pull the data out in a JSON format, and you lose your type fidelity. And that's no fun. All right, so now we're going to talk about security. This isn't MongoDB's fault that 10,000 exposed MongoDB databases were deleted by ransomware groups. These attackers left a message behind for database administrators to contact them asking for bitcoins in return for providing the data. The truth of this situation is, for those of you that haven't had to deal with it, they very rarely actually copy your data. Sometimes they'll encrypt it and bargain for it that way, but very rarely do they copy your data anywhere, and it's just to see if they can get you to send them money. And even if you do, they're probably not going to help you. So make sure you have your backups and keep your database secure. So again, not Mongo's fault. 680 terabytes of data is exposed in MongoDB databases. This was December 2015, but you know, this was February. This one's kind of interesting because you remember those cursing minion toys from, I think it was last summer, right? where the minions were cursing at people? Well, CloudVets had this great idea. They decided, let's make a system where parents, grandparents, children can record messages, save them to the cloud, and then these pets can read those messages and you hear your family member's voice coming out of the pet. Well, these guys got attacked. And for me, the part that's missing here is that the attacker didn't realize what he had, because he had the best marketing opportunity here, right? Your toy starts selling Happy Meals and stuff like that to kids, and yeah, I don't know. So
when you say it's not Mongo's fault,
I'm going to talk about that right now.
Okay.
All right, so the simple reality is that most Mongo security breaches that occur are simply an unsecured Mongo instance running on a default port with an open firewall. It's very common to just deploy Mongo to the cloud, and usually that deployment starts as a proof of concept, and at that stage people are just trying to make it work, is basically what happens. And I think they're trying to keep the interaction simple. For fast access, and you know, using an SSH tunnel or SSHing to a remote box or something like that, well, that'd interfere with the workflow. So, and then when implementation happens, that detail gets lost in the traffic. So, use a firewall in development, because that's make sure that it's properly secured from the start. That way you're used to working with it, how it should be deployed. So by default, Mongo leaves authentication off. The interesting thing is it's not all that uncommon for other DBs to do the same thing. MySQL leaves a root user and a guest user without a password. And the only thing that prevents MySQL from getting the same criticism is they actually do distribute a MySQL secure installation script along with the distribution that pretty much all the documentation says you should run afterwards, and it kind of encourages locking down and cleaning up those users. Not everybody does it. There's still unsecured MySQL databases running with open ports, but you don't hear about it. It's not as common. Most people know that you should secure MySQL when you're setting it up. Mongo has auth. It's had auth for a while. Some of the early versions of auth, arguably not so great, but the situation's improved significantly since then. So it supports SCRAM SHA-1 for user password authentication, supports X509 certificates. And for enterprise versions of Mongo, you can actually do LDAP and Kerberos authentication as well. So good practice, I think, is to generate SSL certificates and just use them from the start. Just get used to setting them up that way. Same thing for MySQL and Postgres, really. Do we all do it? No. No. It takes time to move to that kind of strategy, but you know, it's just a good practice. It's a good starting point. And if you're designing from the ground up, that's where you should start. So obviously, any daemon that you're running, Redis, MySQL, run it as a dedicated user. Mongo's the same. You know, that way if for some reason Mongo ends up getting compromised, it's not your entire system that's compromised. It's just Mongo, and it's just Mongo's data that's at risk. Not that that's a great situation to have, but beats the alternative. MongoDB Enterprise includes an auditing mechanism. So if you have compliance concerns, you'll definitely want the enterprise version. Now, the big thing to know about this is it can significantly increase the write I/O activity. So it's kind of important to think about what you need to audit versus what you don't need to audit, and then apply appropriate filters so that you're not auditing everything. And for deployments with the US Department of Defense, there is a security technical implementation guide. Earlier this week, Postgres actually announced theirs, which is kind of cool. Oracle and I think SQL Server have one, but MySQL is still in progress, has been for years. So if you need that, and then, of course, there is a security checklist in the MongoDB documentation that's worth reading.
Now, as an injection here, man, yeah, I can do this. I went to a BNISSA meeting the other night. That's a security thing. And this guy that talked is talking about if you let user data escape, like every once in a while, you will get a letter from somebody that says, hey, we had a breach, and we're going to give you a year of protection and all that. If you're a larger company, this can cost you hundreds of thousands of dollars and more what you have to go through to protect the people whose data you gave away. And then he went on to say that 60% of small businesses who have a real breach end up going out of business over it. I don't know if that's really true, but that's the number the guy gave out. The security stuff is something to really think about.
Yeah, definitely. And that number doesn't surprise me. I guess if that number surprises me.
I hear it all the time, but I've never gotten a source for it.
It's only that number is so small. Because small business, if you have a serious breach, That very likely could be your business.
Well, because if it does, in fact, I mean, there's stuff you got to notify the attorney general, and you got to do this and that and the other thing, and pay lawyers and send letters to your users, or your customers, or whatever it is, and all that just costs you a ton of money. And you might not have that money if you're a small business.
Well, and when you're looking at insurance
that too.
Issues, insurance may not even cover it, because if you're not following industry standard practices, they may say that this was
due care or due diligence.
Yeah.
Well, the old insurance company trick that you're not necessarily covered for what you think you're covered for.
Yeah. All right, so replica sets. So all members of a replica set share the same data. And replica sets are basically a fault tolerance mechanism that allows for your MongoDB cluster to survive the loss of one or more nodes, or the inability to communicate with one or more nodes. Replica sets can provide for read scaling in scenarios where stale reads are permitted, or where consistent reads and writes are enforced. The default is to read from the primary at all times, but there are read preferences that you can set. Replica set members can also be leveraged for dedicated purposes, such as reporting, backups, or even geographically dispersed disaster recovery. So the node types, you've got the primary, and that's the most important node in the set, which by default is used for all reads and writes for the entire cluster, or for the entire set, to use the right term. When you first initiate a replica set, that node that you do the initiation on becomes the primary. And as you add nodes to the set, they initialize, which means they will copy data from the other members of the set. And then once they've done that copy and read the op log to catch up to the primary, they'll come online as secondaries. Heartbeat statuses are distributed amongst the nodes in the set, and if the primary becomes unhealthy or unresponsive, the remaining nodes in the set, one of them will step up and start an election process, and the majority of nodes in the set must vote in order for the new primary to be elected. Generally speaking, the one that speaks up and says, "Hey, let's have an election," is typically the one that becomes the primary. So with the secondaries, you got to keep in mind that replication is asynchronous, which means that the primary can be ahead of where the replicas are at. By default, the secondary is only there to replicate data from the primary and vote in replica set management operations. The secondary can be configured to accept the reads from Mongo clients, and as I mentioned, there are several different read profiles that can be configured, such as secondary preferred, secondary only, things like that. And then you've got the concept of an arbiter, which is a basic voting node that doesn't actually carry any data. It just carries basic information needed to actually participate in the elections. It requires very minimal resources and can actually live on a server that's doing something else. The important thing being that whatever that other thing is, it's not related to this replica set. So you can't put an arbiter on the same node that's running a secondary, because it wouldn't make sense. Then that node gets two votes instead of one. Kind of defeats the purpose a little bit. All right, so. When a secondary detects the primary to be offline, it's going to suggest the election. A quorum of nodes has to vote, that's what they call the majority, in order for a new primary to be elected. Quorum basically means the majority voting members must cast a vote. You can increase the priority of a given node so that in the event of a failure, it becomes more likely to take over the set than any other node. Basically, it just makes that node check more frequently to see if an election needs to happen. A primary takeover can take about a minute to complete, and so if your application doesn't read from secondaries, it will look like it's completely down. So it's a good idea to, if you are reading from secondaries, go ahead and design your application to continue to function in a read-only mode, if possible. That way it can fail, or have it fail gracefully if it can't write. You can have 50 nodes in a set, but of those, only 7 can be voting nodes. You need to configure a cluster that has 3, 5, or 7 voting nodes so that a network partition can never leave you with a situation of having 50% of the voting nodes on two sides of that partition, on either side of that partition. If you find yourself with an even number of voting nodes, you can add an arbiter so that you have an additional voting member. Now, if the cluster's already down and out, that's not possible. It won't allow you to add nodes easily. I mean, you can force a reconfig, but that's a more complex topic that we're not going to talk about right now. I covered that. So a 7-node cluster can actually remain available and writable through the simultaneous loss of up to 3 nodes. 4 nodes and it goes down. When distributing nodes across data centers, it's important to keep your voting nodes in mind. So over here, we've got our little drawing. And if DC1 goes down, she's ready for that, your cluster is no longer writable. But if DC2 goes, if this stays up and DC2 goes down, your cluster is still writable. So one of the strategies to that is to break out your data centers too, so that your odd-numbered data centers as well with your voting nodes. So if DC1 goes down, DC2 and 3 can still write. Any data center can go down and you can still write to this cluster. So what about other members? So we've got what's called a priority 0 member. And this is a node that can't become a primary, and it can't participate in the election process. It might be a smaller node or a node with a poor geographic location from the app's perspective. Or it could be a node in the process of an upgrade, or it could just be you already have 7 voting nodes in your cluster, so this is just a data node. These nodes are still visible to the application for querying purposes. Then you've got a hidden node, which is a priority 0 node that's actually invisible to client applications. So these would be used for different types of workloads. So if you want a dedicated backups node, or you wanted a dedicated reporting node for some other purpose. And then you've got a delayed node, which is both a priority 0 and a hidden node. And this can actually be set to delay processing of oblog events so that you can have an intentional replication lag. And this basically provides a node that you can use for rapid recovery if somebody does an oops, or if you do a bad release or something like that. Everybody can sync from that node and you can reconfigure your cluster so that he's the primary and he's the source of your data. When using a delayed node, it's important to consider the oplog. So the oplog is a collection of a predetermined and preset size that overwrites the oldest entry when it reaches the end of the log. It basically provides a complete record of all the operations that change data within the replica set. And all members keep a copy of the oplog, and operations can be read from any member of the set. So if you're joining a new member to the set and he's trying to catch up with data and stuff like that, he can actually read his data from one of the secondaries and then pull their oplog too. So operations recorded to the oplog are actually a complete reversible record of changes that are made to the cluster, or sorry, the set. and are guaranteed to only apply once on any given node. As these are designed to be reversible, a delete actually takes as much space in the op log as an insert. So you're not just doing the remove, you're actually saying remove this object. And you've got the whole object right there. So by default, the op log will consume 5% of your disk volume. And it's bound to range between 990 megabytes and 50 gigabytes. For small installations, like development or local use, you can actually send it a small files flag so that it can use a much smaller file. Now, if your application experiences a large amount of write activity, you might need an op log that's larger than these base defaults. So it's a good idea to consider your use case and look at your and keep track of the oldest event in the op log as part of your monitoring so that you're aware, you know, whether your op log goes back 6 hours or 6 days, because that is the amount of time that a secondary node can be out of the cluster and still recover. So, durability. So, Mongo is all or nothing at the document level. It doesn't have the concept of transactions making changes to a document in this collection and another document in that collection. Those aren't bound together. There are different ways to approach that, but it's not a relational transactional database in the standard sense. On a standalone node, a write is considered to be durable when the journal containing that write has been flushed to disk, which basically happens about every 100 milliseconds. In a virtual environment, though, you got to keep in mind that that may not actually be a true flush to disk. So that flush might actually take a bit longer. In a replica set, a write really isn't durable until it's been acknowledged by the majority of the replica set. So you can use write concern to specify that a certain number of voting members of the replica set must acknowledge the write before a success message is returned to the client. Now, just because they've acknowledged it doesn't mean they've actually written it. So that's what journaling is all about, the J. And that specifies the number of voting nodes that must acknowledge that they've written it to their journal before returning to the client. And then it also provides for a timeout so that this doesn't block indefinitely, because it could. So, consistent. A read can be considered consistent when it represents the most current view of permanent data in the cluster. Using read and write concerns can have a dramatic effect on performance, so these should be actually used pretty sparingly. Another concern here is that when you set up, you can set up an impossible write scenario, which is a 7-node cluster with an arbiter where 3 of the nodes have failed. So if you're forcing the writes to be consistent in this scenario, there's not 4 voting members that can be written, and so you're blocked basically. And when you aren't using durable writes, you can encounter rollbacks. So rollbacks should generally be rare, but when they happen, it's usually the result of a network partition. If data is persisted to the primary, but the primary fails before the op log can be read by any of the secondary, fails or becomes disconnected network-wise, the cluster will elect a new primary and continue accepting writes. When the original primary tries to rejoin, it will notice that its op log doesn't have a valid point in the new op log. So it will try to roll back its changes to the point where it diverged from the rest of the replica set. The rollback will happen automatically, and the node will rejoin as a secondary, assuming it can find that divergence point. If the cluster has already moved beyond that op log position, that host will just need to have its data reinitialized. Rollback data is stored in the MongoDB data directory, and it's stored by database collection and timestamp. So to view a human-readable form of that, because it is Bison, you have to use Bison dump. which is installed along with MongoDB. And there is a 300 megabyte limit to how much rollback can be done. And if this is exceeded, an error message will be printed to the Mongo log, and the rollback won't continue. The node will just sit there waiting to be fixed, and your replica set will indicate that this node is not healthy. Tuning and optimization. So the MongoDB log is stored in the database data directory, specified by the log path or sys, or is specified by the log path or syslog options. And you can actually set the slow, the length of time that a query, the threshold at which a query is reported to that log. It defaults to 100 milliseconds. In production, that could actually generate a whole lot of log activity. So you'll want to evaluate if your setting is correct for your needs. You can also use the database profiler, which collects detailed data about Mongo query activity and can be enabled at the database or the node level. By default, this is off. One collects profiling data for slow operations only, and two collects profiling data for all operations. So this gives you a pretty good in-depth view of how Mongo is accessing your data. Profiler can be enabled globally, but it's not recommended for production because it's a significant hit to performance to turn this on. And you can add an explain to any query that will show you what the execution path is and how it's accessing data, how many rows it's scanning, or how many documents it's scanning, I should say. It helps you identify which indexes are used and determine what indexes might be missing. So then you've got a suite of tools that have been built for Mongo. I don't know how to say his name. I believe he's one of the Mongo developers. At least he is now. Mlog filter can slice and dice Mongo log files by time, can merge multiple log files, filter slow queries, search for query patterns, or search for any patterns, really. And it can convert all that data to JSON for you so that you can, I don't know, do something creative like throw it in Mongo. Mlog info returns specific information of interest from the log file with information about things like restarts, connections, Mongo versions. Mlog queries helps you visualize the log files. Mlog viz is an interactive log visualizer that you can use from a web browser. Mlaunch is a set of tools that help you create complex test environments. So if you want to quickly spin up a replica set, you want to quickly spin up a sharded cluster, it provides options for quickly doing that. Obviously, nothing it creates should really be used with production, but it's a good way to set up your local environment if you want to do some testing on those tools. And then mgenerate, which will generate structured data based on templates that you can use with testing and development. So operating system configuration. This is probably one of the big ones. Disable transparent huge pages. Database workloads perform really poorly with transparent huge pages enabled because they have a sparse rather than a contiguous memory access pattern. And this holds true for most other databases too. I'm not aware of any that work well with transparent huge pages. It's usually only an issue when you're talking about a larger memory instance. I think I've only really seen it be an issue on something over about 30 gigabytes of memory. Using your file system, XFS and ext4 are the popular ones. XFS actually tends to work better with MongoDB. And it's highly recommended for the Wired Tiger storage engine specifically. Use no add time. Most Linux distributions now use no rela time or something like that. But for a database, you really probably should still be using no add time. This basically means don't update timestamps for a file just because the file was accessed. raise the U limit or set it to unlimited. U limit basically is designed on Linux to keep a single user or service from capitalizing on too many system resources. In production, you should use, you should be dedicating a node to Mongo anyway, so you should kind of give it full power over the available system resources. We already talked about using a dedicated OS user, but we'll talk about it again, and limit it so that it can only run the Mongo binaries and access the Mongo data. And then this is one that people don't spend a lot of time thinking about. Well, I guess they do in this context. Configure NTP, keep the timestamps of your servers in sync, and we will talk about that more in a few minutes. All right, so sizing and memory use. So like most real-time database systems, Mongo optimizes its reactivity by storing as much data in memory as possible. That makes it very memory heavy. Mongo primarily uses the file system cache for storing its working set in memory. At cache capacity, the next disk read will result in Mongo looking for the thing that hasn't been accessed in the greatest amount of time. It's not necessarily the oldest thing, but just the thing that hasn't been read for the longest period of time. And it'll free up its pages so that it can, so that that space can be reused by the data coming in. Resident memory in Mongo can actually be larger than the working set. Can also be smaller than the working set. They're only loosely tied. Sorry. Journaling can have a significant impact on the resident memory size due to how it works with private views and mapping that data during write operations. After data is synced to disk, the memory remains allocated as cache, but the actual resident memory of Mongo will actually drop back down. So working set is the active indexes and subset of your data that's frequently accessed. And there used to be some halfway decent tools, but they actually removed them in 3.0. So Wired Tiger has some tools for helping estimate working set size, and that no longer does. So you kind of have to go back to just an experienced eye, an experienced sysadmin eye, of being able to look at a system and say, yeah, this cache is probably thrashing, which looks a bit like this. So on the top you've got your CPU usage, and on the bottom you have disk read operations. You can see the disk writes are almost nil. Anybody got a guess as to, I'll give a hint, this is an Amazon volume. Anybody got a guess as to why that looks like that, why it looks so flat? I'll give you a hint, it's an 80 gigabyte volume.
It's full?
No, so it looks like this because it's a GP2 volume, which provides 3 IOPS per gigabyte. So it's running at about 250 IOPS average. So about 240 IOPS would be the throughput of that volume once it's reached its bursting capacity. Once it's used all of its bursting credits up. But basically this is what you get when you are doing a lot of reads. You get a lot of IO weight and you get a large amount of IO reads. This is an indication that one, the volume needs better IOPS, and two, the database either needs to be indexed so it's not reading as much data, which is where it fell off the cliff there, thankfully. Or it needs a larger memory footprint for the instance. Scaling out, sharding. I said sharding. There we go. All right. So sharding allows you to scale out horizontally using commodity hardware, is the basic idea, the basic premise. By creating and mapping where data should live based on a shard key. Each shard actually stores a unique subset of your data and can be a standalone node or, sorry, I should have clicked twice there. Standalone node or a replica set. In production, each of your shards should be backed by a replica set. And the same availability concerns considerations around where they're located as far as the data center and how many there are apply to each individual shard as they would to any replica set. A Mongo S is a shard-aware routing service. It's not a load balancer, but basically they can calculate based on the shard keys where in your sharded cluster a specific data item should live. Darn it. And of course they do that by talking to the config servers, which keep track of where your data lives in the cluster, and for a collection that has sharding enabled, how many chunks live in a given cluster, and where those chunks are, and what the ranges are that each one should be storing. So the big thing with shard keys is that you have to be really careful when you're picking them. You get to choose your shard key for each collection, and not all of your collections need to be sharded just because you've chosen sharding. But you really have to choose wisely. How the data is distributed will affect how your sharded cluster performs and how easy it is to scale. There's a lot of variability in how you choose that key that's going to depend on how your application accesses and stores data. There are both valid use cases for distributing load and data evenly across the cluster, or for wanting data distributed but the active data being stored on a single cluster or a single shard. So you'll kind of need to evaluate which is going to be the right fit for your specific data model. All right, so shard keys, they're immutable fields. You need to choose things that aren't going to change. You can base a shard key on one or more fields. Those fields have to be present in every document that's in that collection. And they have to be indexed. If you're sharding an existing collection, you're going to have to add the index in advance. If you're sharding a new collection, it's going to automatically create the index for you. And collection shard keys cannot be changed, really. They can be changed, but you have to extract your data from the database and put it back in to do it. So they can't be changed for all intents and purposes. Or you can bring everything back in from the shards. You can de-shard a collection. There's a lot of implications to doing that. Drain a shard, that's the term I'm looking for. So the shard key partitions things into ranges of chunks. Chunks are a group of data determined by creating a range on the shard key. The shard key can be a range like dates. Most use cases you wouldn't use like a created at, because a created at is going to put everything within the current range on a single shard. So you're going to end up with all your old data distributed around these old other shards, and all your current data is going to go to one shard. But maybe that's your use case. Maybe this is a high performing shard, and maybe the rest of it is kind of like your archival place, right? So, considerations. So sharding adds a lot of complexity, and some of the functions aren't compatible with a sharded collection. Some of the functions within Mongo, so it can make it more difficult to work with. Not every collection is going to benefit from sharding, and not every collection is going to have appropriate keys to be sharded.
Would you rather a question now or
go ahead?
Okay. So when we used Mongo before, actually one of the on the last slide, we had an issue with choosing our key, and it required us to have to eventually drain and choose different collections in a different shard. But you want an immutable field, like you said, right? And date's nice and handy for that. So when, do you have any good sense of what a better choice is if we were doing social and traditional media, right? So we wanted to be able to roll off what you would do in a normal SQL sort of thing. You'd have, I forget what the SQL.
Partition.
Yeah, so you'd want to have a partition that you can then roll off when it's, you know, 18 months old or, right, whatever.
Yeah.
Get rid of the oldest one.
But you want an even distribution of your data,
yeah,
across the cluster.
Right.
So you could use a hash, well, at least in the current
mm-hmm.
versions of Mongo, you could use a hash
right.
shard key, and you could use the ID as a hashed shard key.
Mm-hmm.
Because once you hash it, it's not going to have a time-based, monotonically
okay.
increasing number, right, anymore?
Yeah, but then draining out the,
so
well,
then you, to drain, to remove old data,
yeah.
you're searching on created at.
Right. Yeah, and that ended up just putting such a bad drain on across all the shards that was a horrible idea too. So, all right. So that is enough. That's what we should do, right? Is we hash the date and we get the distribution, but
I'd probably hash the ID rather than hashing the date since it's already
yeah.
an index key.
Yeah.
And yeah, I guess you could hash the date too. But don't take my word for it. Definitely
yeah.
do like a Stack Overflow search and
yeah.
say,
yeah.
hey, you know, I haven't really had to do much sharded cluster work beyond the education.
Yeah.
So my work is experimental.
Well, I mean, it's just good to see that, you know, we weren't crazy and
yeah.
These
hurt.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, it hurt.
All right, so.
That's why they call them shards.
Shards of glass. All right, since chunks can move between shards at any time, it's important to stop the balancer when taking backups so that the data is consistent across the cluster during the backup process. Make sure you're doing backups. Make sure you're testing your backups. I love saying that. The balancer is basically the component that that determines that a given chunk of data has gotten too large and the chunk needs to be split, or the number of chunks on a given host are there's too many of them and should be migrated to one of the other shards in the set. So when you're doing large data imports, you should actually pre-split the ranges that you're going to need. That way, Mongo's not trying to do it while you're importing. And that way, Mongo's not trying to move data around while you're importing, because all of that's going to slow the import process down. And if you pre-split things, it's also going to distribute the load of the import across the entire cluster as you go. There we go. Monitor your cluster for shard hotspots. Watch load on your shards, especially on your primaries, and make sure you're not getting into a situation where one shard is significantly more heavily used than another. This might indicate that you've selected a poor shard key, or you have a suboptimal chunking of the data. You might actually have to go in and manually intervene and do some chunk splitting of your own and actually do some forced data migrations between the shards.
All of which is possible.
It's not the funnest thing in the world, but it's possible. All right, so monitoring. So you pretty much want the typical monitoring that you would use with any other system. In addition to that, it's especially important that you're keeping an eye on the connections. Each connection for Mongo uses up to and around 1 megabyte of memory. So you actually want to be careful to limit the number of connections that are allowed and monitor that you aren't running out of available connections. When you're doing this, you have to remember that every node in the cluster maintains its own connection to every other node. And each client maintains a separate connection to monitor the state of the replica set. So it's got one of those to each of the nodes as well. And you're monitoring will also create connections. And in a sharded cluster, you've got the additional overhead of connections between the config servers and the primaries, as well as between the primaries and each sharded, within each shard, in order to enable chunk migrations from one to another. Generally speaking, the primary will have the highest connection count at any given time. Of course, your primary can move from one node to another, so who's the primary can change over time. You want to make sure that you have an adequate oplog history to allow a failed node or a node that's being used for some other purpose to rejoin the set, or if it falls too far behind, or to allow a delayed replication if you're using one, if you're using a delayed replication node. A minimum would probably be about 24 hours of history. By default, when we're working with MySQL Postgres, we try to maintain at least 24 hours for MySQL and about 33 hours for Postgres. Doesn't always work that way, but that's what we try for. A minimum, so there could be valid reasons to keep a longer oplog, because in many ways the oplog can actually act as an audit trail. And you can go back and parse through the oplog and actually read the events and see what has changed about the database over time. So rs.printReplicationInfo provides human-readable information such as status of the cluster and actually prints out the current number of hours of data available in the oplog. And db.getReplicationInfo is actually more useful for like scripted checks because it returns a JSON document that that includes extended details about the current state of the cluster. Oh, and there they are. Should collect. When you are using replica sets, you should monitor that the replica set nodes are not falling significantly behind in processing the oplog from the primary. Typically, you would expect secondaries to be within a few milliseconds or seconds of the primary. You should monitor the rollback for the rollback state of a node so that you can generate an alert if a member does have to do a rollback, and so that you can take a look at what data it rolled back in case that's important. When using a sharded cluster, it's important to monitor the state of the balancer and alert if that's not running in case somebody disables it and forgets about it. You might, if you're doing a backup, for example, you might do this. So one of the approaches is, you know, you're checking the state of the balancer. If it's bad, you know, check to see if the backup's running as part of your alert. And if the backup's running, maybe you ignore that until it hasn't been running for a significant period of time. Obviously, if your backups are taking a significant amount of time, that's something you're going to want to watch too. And so then there's NTP health. This one's kind of one of my pet peeves. If you look at most of the monitoring stuff out there, it doesn't actually monitor that NTP is doing what it's supposed to be doing. And NTP has this habit of connecting to servers and staying connected to those servers, and if those servers die, it still tries to get updates from those servers. And so you can, if all three servers that it's connecting to die, it can start to drift, or it can crash, or it can do things like that. And nobody actually keeps an eye on it to make sure that it's running. I looked and looked and I couldn't find a check, so I wrote a shell script that can actually monitor the NTP health and make sure it's within a certain amount of time, and it actually restarts it if it's not. But that's one that people forget about. So clock drift is most critical for older clusters, things before 3.0. Those nodes need to be, the config nodes in those clusters need to be within 30 seconds of each other in order for distributed locks to work properly. With replica set config servers, this is less important, but NTP is pretty important still for your sanity, if nothing else. Usually, if you're investigating what went wrong on a Mongo cluster, you're looking at logs from that server, and you're looking at logs from that server, and if the timestamps don't match, you're going to wind up cross-eyed. All right, so some standard limits. 2 gigabytes per file, 16,000 files per database, 64 terabytes per server. When using journaled, it's 128 if you're not, but don't use not journaled. And 32-bit systems limit you to 2 gigs of total data. Don't use 32-bit systems for MongoDB. You can't move between without dumping and restoring your data with a logical backup anyway. Just, it's not worth it. Let's not even talk about it anymore. So who offers MongoDB as a service? These are the popular ones, or the common ones right now. MongoDB Atlas actually looks really slick. They've actually got sharding figured out and built right into it. I don't think anybody else does. Engineered solution will. That's part of our goal. Our current add-on solution does not, although some people have managed to hack around that. So, as for integration, it's got supported drivers for pretty much any language you can think of: PHP, Ruby, Java, Python, C. So current mainstream ones anyway. There are community drivers available for a lot of the less popular languages as well. Hadoop is able to connect and extract data from Mongo, can also push data down into Mongo, so that can also be passed on to anything Hadoop compatible, big data systems, or vice versa. And there's a bunch of admin UIs, monitoring, Wireshark, Moonin, that all talk to Mongo as well. And then there's also the MongoDB Operations Manager, which is a subscription-based service available from MongoDB themselves. That's what replaced MMS, Mongo Monitoring Service or System, I'm not sure which it was. So, considerations. Always read the manual, especially if you're trying to kill fuzzy white rabbits. Thank you very much. Any questions? Okay, cool.
Well, I guess this is not quite a question. One of the real weird quirks we had when we were working with Mongo was the way that they did UUIDs required that you use a JavaScript UUID generator, because the C and the C++ tools generated it differently in a way that was really hard if you were just trying to match on UUID. We were on an early 2 version. I don't remember which one anymore. So maybe that's fixed, and maybe that was part of our real pain on trying to remove old documents, was we knew what the doc ID was. We couldn't search for that doc ID ever because the UUID wouldn't match. So it's not quite a question, but if you find you're using Mongo and you are using UUIDs somewhere in the documents and they don't match, try to use a different, it had to do with the way that it would convert the UUID for fast lookup, like a big Indian, little Indian sort of matchup problem. That's not quite a question, but it's a warning, and maybe they fixed it in the later editions of it.
Yeah, I'm not sure. That's not a situation I've encountered, so. Mongo's logs are really, really helpful too. They tend to be very verbose, and they tend to say pretty clearly what's going on. Very searchable on Stack Overflow and similar, Google.
I guess one of the big surprises for us using it was also it wouldn't, when it makes, if when you did that update to the document, it doesn't update the document in place. It updates it. It has to move the document to update
right.
The document.
So no in-place updates.
Right. Which may not matter. You shouldn't. Well, like you said, you shouldn't be changing anything that it would shard on, so it shouldn't mismatch in that way. But you will end up seeing a lot more disk I/O than you would expect, given the amount of updates you're doing.
Yeah, and over time you build up fragmentation. But
yep.
I mean, that's somewhat similar to how Postgres and MySQL have historically done it
yeah.
as well.
Yeah.
And,
yeah, yeah, yeah.
you know, either if the data doesn't fit in this space that I have, mm-hmm. especially with things like varchar.
Yeah.
You know, because everything else is pre-located, but varchar, text, whatever.
Yeah.
If it doesn't fit here, okay, then I got to move everything.
Right.
And when you're talking about a document, the document could be quite large. A document could be up to 2 gigabytes.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, that's maybe a little crazy, but I don't judge.
A lot of phone numbers.
All right, well, thank you guys for coming and being a great audience. Swag is on the table in the back, stickers, t-shirts donated from sponsors and other entities. Next month, MongoDB is going to send me some stickers, so I'll be bringing those to the Lightning Talks. Anything that's on the swag table is free. People have asked about that before, so yeah, swag is free. Take it, enjoy it, wear it, use it in good health. All right, have a good night.
Thanks.